The James Webb Telescope, ready to solve many mysteries. The launch of the James Webb Space Telescope is now less than a month away. If the God of Space Exploration wills it, on December 22nd, an Ariane launcher will bring into orbit the most perfect and expensive astronomical machine ever built by man, and then direct it to the distant Lagrange 2 region, a quiet and sheltered gravitational oasis from where it will begin to investigate the universe. While we pray that everything will go well, it will not be bad to try to understand what this technical prodigy can really do for us. His name is Webb, James Webb, and it will be the space telescope that is now universally considered the successor to the Hubble Space Telescope. This new instrument is also named after one of the American fathers of space exploration. Edwin Hubble is the astronomer known for having formulated in 1929, together with Milton Humason, the empirical law on the speed of recession of galaxies, which confirmed the hypothesis of the expansion of the universe. James Webb was the second administrator of NASA, called in 1961 to lead the space agency by John Fitzgerald Kennedy to make reality his historic speech, "We choose to go to the moon," a dream then crowned in 1969 with the Apollo 11 mission. So now the name of Webb is inextricably linked to the most advanced instrument to investigate the universe that we are going to launch outside the atmosphere. Until a few days ago, the plans included the launch of the James Webb Space Telescope on December 18th, but the date has now been moved to the 22nd due to minor setbacks, which NASA ensures to be of little importance. If so, for at least 5 years, we can see the two telescopes' extraterrestrial work together, waiting, hopefully as late as possible, the final retirement of Hubble, and at least after having blown out the 13th candle of its activity in orbit. The JWST is now universally considered Hubble's heir, but it will not be trivially its modernized copy. What are its main features and how does it differ from HST? From the standpoint of implications for astrophysics, the most important differences are twofold. First, JWST's primary mirror, which is 6.5 meters in diameter, is nearly 3 times larger than that of HST, which means that the photon-collecting surface in JWST will be about 7 times larger than in Hubble. A telescope this large has never been launched into space. Essentially, JWST is a telescope similar in size to large ground-based telescopes, slightly smaller than ESO's Very Large Telescope, but operating in the space environment away from Earth with very little light pollution and without the image deterioration problems due to Earth's atmosphere. JWST is optimized for infrared observations, particularly in the wavelength band between 1 micron and 27 microns, a region of the spectrum where phenomena and objects otherwise invisible in other bands are observable. Phenomena and objects that will be imaged with two types of digital sensors, visible to near-infrared arrays with 2048 by 2048 pixels, and mid-infrared arrays with about 1024 by 1024 pixels. Webb's angular resolution or sharpness of vision will be the same as Hubble's, but in the near-infrared. This means that Webb's images will appear just as sharp as Hubble's do. Webb will have an angular resolution of somewhat better than 0.1 arc seconds at a wavelength of 2 micrometers. An arc second is the 1800th part of the apparent diameter of the lunar disk. Seeing at a resolution of 0.1 arc second means that the Webb could see details the size of a US penny at a distance of about 40 kilometers. Only two factors affect how sharp an image is: the diameter of the mirror and the wavelength being observed. They are mathematically related. Resolving ability is proportional to wavelength over diameter. So the shorter the wavelength and the bigger the diameter, the sharper your images will be. Webb is optimized to see deeper into the infrared than Hubble and has a much larger mirror, as well as state-of-the-art detectors. Its imagery will be detailed and spectacular. JWST will allow a giant leap in almost all areas of astronomy. To give an idea of this improvement, just think that in some spectral bands, the sensitivity of JWST will be about 100 to 1,000 times higher than any telescope available at the time. Such a leap is equivalent in terms of sensitivity to moving abruptly from the Galileo telescope to the Very Large Telescope. The fields of investigation of JWST will therefore be vast. One of the areas for which there is the greatest excitement and expectation is the study of the atmospheres of planets in other solar systems. JWST, in fact, will allow the identification of different molecular species in the atmospheres of extrasolar planets, will allow the characterization of the physical properties of these atmospheres, and will also allow the assessment of whether some of these planets have conditions suitable for the development of life. The sensitivity of JWST in the infrared bands will be crucial to penetrate the dense dust clouds in which new stars form in our galaxy, as well as in other galaxies, and will therefore allow us to study in detail the processes that leads to the formation of stars, as well as the formation of planets in circumstellar disks. The first scientific results will come from the Early Release Science Program, based on 13 proposals chosen from over 4,000 astronomers from around the world. About 70% of Webb's observing time will be for spectroscopy. If a picture is worth 1,000 words, a spectrum is worth 1,000 pictures. In addition, 20 teams were chosen for archival research and theoretical work. Altogether, this initial series of observations will cover a vast range of astronomical targets and subjects. We'll look at the solar system, including Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune, Pluto, Eris, Sedna, Enceladus, Titan, where NASA is sending a helicopter, and Europa, where NASA is sending a probe to look for organic molecules in the moon's warm water geysers. We'll look to Proxima Centauri, itself about the size of Jupiter, with at least one planet of its own, as well as Alpha Centauri, which also might have planets. We'll look at transiting worlds around red dwarf stars like TRAPPIST-1 and hunt for signs of planetary atmospheres. We'll look into the famous deep fields pioneered by Hubble to peer further back in time and see, we hope, signs of the first galaxies being born. We'll look through nature's telescopes, gravitational lenses, which are clusters of galaxies whose gravitational pull magnifies the images of even more distant galaxies behind them. Some of these lenses magnify their backgrounds by a factor of 10,000, which gives us a chance to see individual stars in the early universe. Closer to home, we'll look at the Trapezium, the star cluster that makes up the middle star in Orion's sword, where Galileo saw three stars by pressing his eye to his tiny telescope. Our infrared camera will reveal 1,000 newborn stars. And really close to home, when another interstellar interlooper like Oumuamua comes by, we'll be ready to see if it's a solid nitrogen pancake. But what might we find that is completely unexpected? Dark matter, dark energy, and the black holes at the centers of most galaxies stand out as truly special and have won their discoverers a rash of Nobel Prizes in the last decade. Webb cannot directly see dark matter, the unseen matter that makes up a large fraction of the mass of galaxies and clusters of galaxies, but Webb can measure its effects. One of the best ways to measure mass is through the gravitational lens effect. As described by Einstein's general relativity theory, a light beam passing near a large mass will be slightly deflected because space-time is disturbed by the presence of mass. By taking pictures of distant galaxies behind nearby galaxies, astronomers can calculate the total amount of mass in the foreground galaxies by measuring the disturbances in the background galaxies. Because astronomers can see how much mass is present in stars in the foreground galaxies, they can then calculate how much of the total mass is missing, which is presumed to be in the dark matter. Also, Webb will observe many statistics of galaxy evolution, and scientists can compare these observations to theories of the role that dark matter played in that process, leading to some understanding of the amount and nature of the dark matter in galaxies. I'm guessing that perhaps some kinds of objects formed in the early universe have all disappeared, so we can't find them now. Maybe there were immense stars, thousands or millions of times the mass of the Sun, but burning out and turning into black holes and flying debris. Maybe dark matter was turning directly into black holes, or maybe these strange objects are still there but masquerading as something else. Or perhaps there's something about exoplanets. Today we know of thousands of them. We know that planets about the size and temperature of Earth are common, and maybe 20% of all stars have them. With the Webb, we will search these planets for evidence of water, which we suspect is a requirement for life. Searching for oxygen is harder and we probably won't see it, but it would be a strong sign of photosynthesis. The Webb will be able to detect the presence of planetary systems around nearby stars from their infrared light. Heat. It will be able to see directly the reflected light of large planets, the size of Jupiter, orbiting around nearby stars. It will also be possible to see very young planets in formation while they are still hot. Webb will have coronagraphic capability, which blocks out the light of the parent star of the planets. This is needed as the parent star will be millions of times brighter than the planets orbiting it. Webb will not have the resolution to see any details on the planets. It will only be able to detect a faint light speckle next to the bright parent star. Webb will also study planets that transit across their parent star. When the planet goes between the star and Webb, the total brightness will drop slightly. The amount that the brightness drops tells us the size of the planet. Webb can even see starlight that passes through the planet's atmosphere, measure its constituent gases, and determine whether the planet has liquid water on its surface. When the planet passes behind the star, the total brightness drops, and we can again determine more of the planet's characteristics. But what's next? Just as Webb was conceived before Hubble even left Earth's surface, astronomers and engineers are already planning for the next generation of telescopes in space and on the ground. The European Space Agency's 1.2-meter Euclid telescope is scheduled to launch in 2022 and will survey much of the sky to hunt for evidence of dark matter and dark energy. NASA's larger Nancy Grace Roman Space Telescope, with a 2.4-meter mirror, the same size as Hubble's, is planned for launch around 2026 and will take in 100 times as much sky in one bite as Hubble. On the ground, the 8.4-meter Vera Rubin Observatory and its 3-gigapixel camera will survey the whole observable sky from its location every 3 nights, finding millions of short-lived transient events on every sweep, like supernovae, near-Earth objects, and matter falling into black holes. And JWST is ready and able to serve as a follow-up telescope for these finds. If a discovery needs an immediate response, we can do it within 2 days or less. Even larger ground-based telescopes, the 24-meter Giant Magellan Telescope, the 30-meter telescope, and the 39-meter Extremely Large Telescope, are under construction. They are perfect for spectroscopy, which requires more light than taking images, and will be capable of imaging exoplanets, though not quite as small as Earth, around nearby stars. None will be easy to build, but all are possible. In my opinion, each project is worthy of astronomers' time and effort. Together, they could keep us fully occupied for at least half a century. Future generations will celebrate their accomplishments. More treasures await.